Hello, folks. It's another Friday. Good evening. Welcome. I'm Citizen Jones. The Hangout is already here. And today on the program, heavily armed bandits invade university, kidnap two, and raid shops just as police arrest suspected kidnappers while collecting ransom. Nine prime suspects in the invasion of Justice Odili's house, Attorney General office, exchange words, and later on the show, House of Reps Speaker Bajabia Miller justifies his support for direct primaries for political parties. I'm hanging out with Emeka Madunagu. Emeka, I greet you.
Yes.
And we also have Paul Dada. Paul, Emeka's Anambra State just achieved what I call a fait accompli, you know, for Anambra State. So we greet him. We rejoice with him.
I greet him back.
Okay. And just to inform you, Babajide Kolade Otitoju is joining us from Abuja. We'll take him via Skype. That's it. The team is ready. I hope you are. By taking you to Niger State. That state is still yoking under the pangs of banditry. The Federal University of Technology, FUT, MENA, was stunned on Wednesday at their permanent site, Gidankwano, I hope that is right, as suspected bandits raided shops opposite the main gate of the institution. Two people were kidnapped. The outlaws came from entrance, shall we say, route, but on motorcycles. They shot sporadically to spread panic. Police reacted to the distress calls. Two suspects were felled and others apprehended while collecting ransom. Emeka, we've been there before, and we still are yoking under bandits.
Niger State is, you know, a particularly pathetic case. I mean, because it's a state in the grips of Boko Haram and bandits. Boko Haram insurgents are said to be controlling about 500 communities. I think that was the governor that said so in Niger State. And you know, Niger State should be about the biggest state, the largest state in Nigeria. Yeah. Yes, you know, the largest territory. So if bandits and Boko Haram can roam freely in a state like Niger, then what hope for other states? You know, and it surprises me that the governors of northern states have not been able to think through a simple, you know, solution to this problem that is that they have turned from a that they have turned into a mountain.
Emeka, what you have just said provokes another question. You think the governors have the answers to this lingering corrupt problem?
Of course, I mean, they have their ears everywhere. They have their people, they have their eyes everywhere. They ought to know the fact that, you see, they can't rely on the existing security architecture. They've done a lot in the past, you know, giving the military money to get equipment, to do all of that, the police and all of that. So they have to adopt unconventional means to deal with this problem. I won't help them to do their jobs, because that's why they were elected as governors. That's why every month they collect huge security votes. That's why they are called chief security officers, and they are chief executives. Now, as chief executives, they have a lot at their disposal with which they can put this thing to a permanent end. Yeah. And it won't take, it's not rocket science. They can find solutions to these things. Tell me, how would so-called bandits attack shops in front? Because they are worse than bandits. These are terrorists. Mm. So it's even a thin line between banditry and terrorism. Because where you have Boko Haram said to be controlling about 500 communities, so how are you sure it's not Boko Haram?
Bandits also spread terror.
No, but yes. Mm. And you see, Boko Haram is actually, you know, if you remember, a former Inspector General of Police had actually said that is an offshoot of Boko Haram called Ansaru that moved down to Kogi State at that time and attacked a convoy of military officers. Yeah. And then, you know, started moving in other in different directions. Yeah. So, and now, when we keep talking about bandits, what kind of bandits are they? Are these not offshoots of Boko Haram? Are these not offshoots of ISWAP and other because terrorist organizations they are, they, around?
Their modus is almost the same.
Yeah, operating around the Sahel.
Yeah. Paul, he's not necessarily speaking for you, but but then when he says governors have the answer to can call the bluff of bandits, it sets me thinking, is this really true, necessarily?
It's not just what the governors alone can do. Governors, yes, maybe they have to step up their game. The military, we have also called for coordinated attacks by the military, you know, on several bandit camps. But even all of these are not enough. Because, you know, dealing with bandits, attacking them, to me, it's good, but sometimes it's like dealing with the symptoms of a disease. It's like when you have malaria, you know, you have pains, you are taking a paracetamol. Paracetamol is a pain reliever.
Yeah,
you still have to take the anti-malaria. Mm. But if you take only paracetamol, it will not work.
So
you have to take
paracetamol.
I'm trying to make an analogy. Now, what I'm saying is this. We know, if you look at sometimes when these bandits are arrested, you see scrawny-looking individuals.
Mm.
And you say, are these the ones collecting the millions of naira? Certainly, they are not. Now, there are people behind this. Now, if you don't go after the sponsors, and it is not that they don't know, Niger State Governor some time ago said it himself. He's the chief security officer of that state. He said there were people in his government, he said it, we heard him, that we in his government that were sympathetic towards the bandits. That were in cahoots with the bandits. He said it himself, and nothing has come out of it.
Yeah, because he would have said that from an informed position.
Exactly. Mm. Now, we know security agents, law enforcement agents, governors know some of the top shots.
Okay.
They even know the people behind these bandits. We even hear of bandits asking people to pay ransom to a commercial bank. Yes, we've heard that as well.
Of course.
The commercial bank.
The commercial bank was named. And from the story, I think they said that even the commercial bank said, no, please, we can't. I beg.
So how did the information originate?
Of course, it was traced.
It was traced. So what I'm trying to say, is that you need to get the people, the faces behind, we need to uncover the faces behind this terror. Otherwise, you are just dealing with symptoms, like I said.
Yeah, yeah.
Deal with the men or the women behind this terror, the acts of terror.
Okay. We'll turn things now over to our man in the nation's capital, Babajide Kolade. Okay. We hear Jide is not quite ready for us now. But let's go. Emeka, you know, you remember in the President Jonathan Days, he mentioned in passing, even in my government, some people are known
of course
to be sympathetic to blah 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 blah, and so which is saying he had information.
Let me tell you,
Emeka, where I'm going is this: almost every state in this country, including my Akwa Ibom, had criminalized kidnapping to the point of making it a capital offense. But how many people have been brought to court?
Are they ready to bring these people to court? And don't forget, these criminals are operating in states that mainly APC states. The president and commander-in-chief is of the APC. Check the states. No, we can start counting them. Let's start counting them. It's not something hidden. So if the governors are telling me that they cannot, within their party, work with the commander-in-chief to put an end to this, then I wonder what they're telling us. I want to ask Emefiele, this governor of Central Bank, he has been busy pursuing, you know, cryptocurrency operators, pursuing young people doing their businesses. Why can't Emefiele come down hard on commercial banks? That we understand you people are actually conduits for ransoms. You are conduits for sponsors of terrorists. You are conduits for kidnappers. You are conduits for Boko Haram. Some days ago, a federal high court judge, he listed two banks. I said their licenses should be withdrawn because they assisted in, you know, they helped you know, somebody whom the court convicted to move public funds. And he said their licenses ought to be withdrawn. Why hasn't Emefiele come down on these people very hard? if you cut the source of supply, you have substantially cut off the oxygen.
Exactly.
Then, go back to the states. In the states where these governors are, there are retired military personnel just languishing away. Retired security personnel. Engage these people. Engage them.
They are useful.
They are very useful. Engage these people. Some of them are still young, vibrant, maybe short service commission. Engage these people. If you have to tell President Muhammadu Buhari, listen, we need, if we have to use whatever kinds of weapons, it's not dangles, another. If we have to use the AK-47 and deploy them against these people, you see, this is a serious disease that can destroy so many things in this country.
Oh, yeah.
We have to come down hard and clear these people. Otherwise, we don't know how far these people will go to the market, kill people, and just walk away.
They have what they call a field day.
The state government will close down markets, they will can't open reopen the markets, they will impose taxes. Come on, what is going on? Why is the Nigerian state, you know, seemingly helpless in the face of all of these things going on? What is going on?
But, you know, they say talk is cheap because the supply is great, even though the need is not that great. So we are saying that the answer is in the question.
Exactly.
The answer is in the question.
See, what we keep getting from even the people in authority is analysis. They analyze like we do here. They just tell us what the problem is. Like I mentioned, Niger State the governor, they tell you people in my government are this and this. So what have you done about it? What have you done about it? We've said banks are used as conduits. It's an open secret. We know. What have you done about it? Okay? But when...
And first of all, do you agree with the position that banks are used?
Then investigate.
Yeah.
Investigate. If you want to be very sure, investigate. But I'm very sure they know. See, the people in the community want to work with government, get their confidence. In Ogun State, where some kidnappers were arrested at the point of collection of ransom, the authorities work with these safe cops, this community.
So safe cops.
So work with the people. And again, it also reinforces the need for policing, police formations. I'm not the community policing they are doing now.
But you know, a retired police officer said years ago, if you allow the police do its job, it's the police's job to bust the bubble of kidnappers, you know, pick information and spread. But Nigerians hardly feel free and safe to volunteer information.
Again, this is because of the impression people have about the police. The police have not done enough to earn the confidence of the people. If somebody dies today, I mean, somebody just falls down on the road and dies, some people say, nobody go carry and go police station. I mean, they will force arrest. There's still that mentality.
Yeah.
The police must realize that it is not, I don't know why we still call it Nigerian police force. It's supposed to be a service.
It's supposed to be a service.
But you know that in reality, it is not. We still have police. Look at what happened recently at Mayor on Lagos.
But Paul, don't let me go there.
No, I'm just saying that the police has no hand.
Yeah. Paul, don't let me go there. You know, we have a policing system we produce. So we merit the police we have. Because what I mean is, Emeka, and hear this. A big boy runs into trouble today. A big girl runs into trouble. A phone call to the police high command sets him free. So we merit the police we have.
Yeah. Absolutely.
So don't just blame the police.
But we can't continue like this. Look, if I don't mind say something, that we cannot continue to do the same thing the same way and expect a different result. We've got to sit down. Is this profitable to us? Many of us, we don't have another country. We don't want this country to implode. This situation has been like this. Some of us are not so old, though we are in our 40s. We have been hearing that things go better. I am sure you have also been hearing that since you were young.
Nigeria go better.
Now our children will hear Nigeria go better. Paul, when are we going to sit down?
Paul, my own song is, there was a country in this country. Whether or not you believe it.
Yes,
the police had not always been like this.
Absolutely, I know. Yes, but there was a time things began to go bad. Yeah, yeah. You know, sometimes when we say, you know, there is a one funny thing. You know, there's one funny thing.
All right.
Sometimes all right. We try to remember what happened in the second
request.
Actually, what we are saying is that let us go back to what. Let us retrogress. It used to be better. Instead of saying we should have made progress from what?
Paul, it might sound very, very stupid to hear a thing like that, but they say the way to go forward is to take a step backward, see where you missed your way.
But we want to just to even go right back to the beginning.
To the First Republic.
All right, there's a call coming in from Abuja. I say good evening, sir. Welcome.
Good evening.
Yeah. Welcome to the show.
Yeah, thank you very much.
What can you tell us?
I want to contribute to the discussion.
Go on.
Yes, good evening. The gentleman just made a good point. Do you know that what is happening in all these northern states, for example, can never happen in River State and never happen in any of the states from Niger Delta? Governors are supposed to have their eyes, their ears everywhere. Imagine bandits will leave a location, come to the town, hit, and go away. Gumi will go and visit them, do meeting with them, and come back, and nothing will happen. Does that mean the governors safe? Are they not? They don't have informants. They don't have people on ground in each of the local government area that will tell them what is happening, where these are coming from. Are they human beings? This will come, hit, and go away. So I believe that people are interested in this thing that is happening, either because of the money they are making, either they are in government and government is supporting them. So for this thing to end, I think the governors have a lot of work to be done. Then those that is gaining financially from this should be apprehended and arrested.
Because it is possible. Very, 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 very possible.
Very possible.
We share your sentiments.
That's a citizen. That's a citizen talking. I mean,
but what the little troubling thing for me is he telling me that it cannot happen in River State.
Well, you know, maybe it's because I don't know where he's calling from.
He's calling from Abuja.
But I think Wike is one of the governors that's taken security very seriously. Very, very seriously. It's one of those. I know, there was a time in River State, kidnapping was a 24/7 affair.
No, it started.
But I think it has gone down.
It
has gone down. You know, even as it was last year, year before. Like,
no. Mine is kidnapping has been outlawed in many states, if not all, including mine. I said so, but no suspect has been brought to court. That's my trouble.
Some suspects have been brought to court, have been convicted. After the other day, a court in, I think, in Ekiti, convicted, I think, a herdsman or so for killing a farmer. Now, but where are the high-profile suspects? High-profile. Yes.
Yeah.
Of course. Some states.
Bring them to court.
Some states, yeah. Well,
name
what
and
I think,
shame.
I think it's
let's
more,
see them.
It's more or less, you know, just playing to the gallery. State governors, they go demolish what, you know, they call the hideouts or operational bases of kidnappers. But where are these people? Bring them to court. Bring the big men to court. But like the caller said, is it possible that there are financial incentives in all the money governors are pumping in to solve this problem? And so certain people, maybe the security establishment or the political establishment, want these things to continue.
You are begging the question, because in many instances, these ransoms are collected in millions.
In cash, but there are some that are funneled through the banks.
Yeah. Many of them in cash.
But I think of recent, the security agencies have been intercepting some of these ransoms.
This story is that many some suspects were nabbed while they were sharing these spoils and so on.
Yes.
The next step, Paul, I want to see them in court.
Exactly.
It's not asking for the son.
Many times we see suspects being paraded, and that's the last.
And that's the end.
We hear of it. So we don't. People must be brought to book. We want to see it being done.
To you, it's showboating.
That's the way it's. That's what it seems like. You know, take them to court. Let's see. Inform us the progress of the case. You know,
because it instills confidence.
And yes, and these cases, I'm sure many of those cases are not very even difficult to prosecute. You understand? This is a kidnapper. You have your evidence. You arrested him when he was collecting ransom. Okay, presenting before the court. Many of these cases, I believe, can be handled very expeditiously, even without.
They can create special courts. Exactly, to fight special terrorism. Courts. Special courts.
I don't think. I don't think bandits will be like a politician who will hire a SAN that will be giving courts tough time. You know, making a filing preliminary objections.
If you be lawyer, won't you make the job interesting?
Yeah, you will. But the state should never abdicate its right over its territory. The state should not be seen to be on the receiving end.
And exactly.
That is why government has power. But the unfortunate thing is that in Nigeria, you see government begging people who should be begging it. And you wonder.
Now, you now have two governments. The government, you know, and the unknown government. I'm borrowing the word of Waladoye was. I said unknown government.
Unknown government, and you wonder, these things can actually be dealt with. And I think the governors should come. But this telecom shutdown, it appears it is not yielding any dividend, because you find out that somehow these criminals are still able to communicate.
Let me share a story with you. The story broke out many years ago. A poor boy, a struggling boy, went to 28-year-old went to a palm reader, and said, "Oga, beg, please look at a palmistry. You know, just look at my palms." The guy said, "Spread your palms," and he did, and said, "Look, you are 28. You'll be poor until you are 30." You know, he has 2 years to go. And the boy asked again, "Yeah, what happens after 30? The palmist said, "You get used to poverty." So we are not getting used to these things. Kidnappers are amongst us. They are not unknown gunmen. I think you said somebody somewhere must be drumming for them somewhere.
Exactly.
And government exists for the benefit of the people and not the other way around. So we trust that government will put paid to call the bluff of bandits, because we can.
Yes.
I guess we can.
Yes. Yes. It's okay. Very doable.
All right. From Niger State, the city question, we have Aliyu. Good evening. Welcome.
Good evening, sir.
All right. I greet you.
All right. I want to contribute to the program.
Yeah, go on, sir.
All right. The truth of the matter is our government is not ready to fight this very issue.
When you say our government, are you talking about Niger or government in Nigeria?
Government in Nigeria as a whole, not particularly Niger.
Okay.
If not so, by this time, we supposed not to be having the issue of kidnapping, bandit going to the school, bandit going to this, bandit going to that, to kidnap people. By this moment, at least, if the government is ready to fight this problem, serious measures could have been put in place. And if we curtail that issue of putting a serious measure, then a serious policy should also be put in place. That any bandit caught, this is the punishment direct. No any issue of going taking him to court. He himself knows that at the time he was caught, this is the punishment going to face.
Yeah, except that
we continue having this issue every day and night. How on earth will somebody leave a typical village and come to a town? Not even the town. He will go to a city, university as a whole, going to kidnap people. How would it be possible in the
Okay then, thank you. We got you first time. Thank you very kindly. Let's go straight to our next story. Well, a word we hear is enough for the wise. All right, well, let's take you to the nation's capital. You know, if you arouse suspicion, every conceivable thing feeds that suspicion. Since October 30th, when security operatives comprising soldiers and police officers invaded the home of Justice Mary Odili in the nation's capital, Abuja, suspicion had been overfed by postulations and deductive reasoning. The Attorney General's office was at the center of it all, if you know what I mean. First PRO, Frank Mba, names the suspects as a fake chief superintendent of police, that's a CSP, a journalist, and an Islamic scholar. 10 other suspects, including 2 military men, are said to be still at large. Now, a twist in the tale is that the AGF, that's the Attorney General of the Federation, Malami's office, has described the said confession as, quote, an orchestrated attempt to stir unnecessary controversies and public apprehension. We've been there before, Paul.
We've been there before. I wasn't too excited because they named, they paraded some suspects. For me, that has even raised more questions. Now, you say that the man is a fake CSP, a fake police officer. How did, who, you know, to what end? What, this, apparently, this weren't, according to what they say.
You don't trust what they said?
No. I can't just take it that way. I wouldn't know. They say, if the man actually also said, I'm not a police officer. I only pretended to be one, but I'm a consultant to the AGF. AGF said, no, I don't know you. Okay. Now, the point, what I'm trying to say is, how did different people from different walks of life, even different agencies, come together to plan this, to plan the invasion, and then what did they want to achieve?
How did they get to get the warrant?
How did they mislead? How were they so audacious to mislead
the house is number 7, but they were given a number 9.
Also, so many questions that we need to actually answer. People were in uniform Wednesday when they went for the invasion. Who were they? And Frank Oba said there were actually people from law enforcement agencies. He said it.
People
from law enforcement, different law enforcement agencies, yeah. If I heard him right. So, okay, this is a fake police officer. What about the other law enforcement agencies? Were they also fake? So, what I'm calling for is what the NBA has called for. I do not have confidence in the investigation that the police has launched.
Don't tell me you don't trust.
No, I will tell you why. I'll tell you why. The police should not be investigating itself. The NBA has called for an independent panel to probe this particular issue. Because he's a policeman, he's not a policeman, he's a consultant, he's not a consultant, all sorts. So we actually need an independent...
Paul, and this is the country of panels.
Well, we've had panels. Well, of course, if there's no investigation, what can we do? We just need to be very sincere with what we are doing. You understand? Let there be a panel, and let the outcome be publicized. Let's have the outcome. Don't escape the fact.
I'm not afraid of a panel, but let there be a panel beater. What do I mean? Something that will beat this setting up of panels. Let the panel, this time, come out with a verifiable report. Because if somebody openly confesses, I'm not a police officer, blah, 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 some people somewhere must be drumming the beat.
I think Malami should step aside from his office. First of all, he should step aside. The integrity of his office has been called to question. Somebody said, I'm a consultant for you. And you are saying you are not a consultant for me. So how do we verify it? Is it because the police have jumped in? No. He's so quick. Is it so easy to just go and invade a residence? It's even because it's the residence of a justice of the Supreme Court. That's why it's attracting.
Emeka, she is married to a politically exposed gentleman.
That even makes it worse. It was the man declared wanted that such a sting operation had to be carried out on his house. We've heard about raids on the homes of ordinary Nigerians. and people disappeared. Oh, who were those who came? When their relatives went looking for them, the police said they don't have them. Mm-hmm. EFCC, we don't have them. This, we don't have them. It's just because it is, you see, somebody, a high-profile person. Mm. That's why it's in attracting all of this. We must put an end. This is impunity. And the fact, you see, I'm not comfortable with the fact that we're only acting because it involves, you know, a high-profile personality.
Yeah. Yeah.
Such things should not even exist, because you have all kinds of agencies, tax forces and others, who raid people's houses, who pick people on the streets, who invade people's offices. They claim maybe they are pursuing tax or one thing or the other. They pick people, they destroy people's you know, properties. They seize. You just see brigandage on the streets. Once people put on all kinds of uniforms on the streets, they just, you know, they manhandle people. They make life unbearable for people. And what is the attraction? That they are putting on a uniform. And this must stop, because that's why you saw a joint recovery panel. Malami now saying that there is no joint recovery, no such panel in the ministry. That should not be enough. He should step aside and let an independent investigation be undertaken into this matter. Because let me tell you something. It has a lot to do. That is the office of the nation's chief law. That's the nation's chief law officer. And once certain things are called into question by the nation's chief law officer, it puts our reputation as a serious nation
on the line.
And then again, Malami also needs to comport himself in line with the high regards due to that office.
I'm wondering if the AGF Abubakar Malami has read 48 Laws of Power. You know, law number 5 is very, very interesting here. Law number 5 says, Emeka and Paul, protect your reputation. It is everything. Protect it with your life. And I think the AGF needs to protect that reputation. But hear this. Emeka used the word impunity. Paul, you know that impunity is provoked by untouchables in society.
Mm.
And untouchables include the carpetbaggers, name it, the so we deserve what we are getting. Don't you think so?
Yes, we deserve what we are getting. And the reason
but we can do more than
we can do more. The problem we are having in our country is that we have men that are stronger than institutions.
Mm.
Institutions drive the health, the progress.
But men drive these institutions.
Institutions. But institutions outlive men.
Mm.
You know, we had, I'm sure you know, remember Edgar Hoover?
Oh, J. Edgar Hoover.
He ran the FBI for 37 years. Presidents feared him.
Mm.
In fact, he died in his 70s. He died of heart attack. I think President Truman said he expressed his fear about the man. This was a man that allegedly took nude photos of people to blackmail them. It was because of him they had to do what? They had to limit the time of FBI directors to 10 years.
Mm.
Because he had it for life. He was a king. He was king. Now, we should allow institutions to thrive. I do not disagree with Emeka when he said the man should step aside. Yes. Even in this administration, we have seen a former SGF, you know, indicted in corruption, and he was removed.
Yeah.
And the man is facing
even minister, yeah. Exactly. President.
We've seen a minister indicted for NYSE certificates for forgery, and then she had to leave that office.
Was it Fabian, was it Naji? And then Adolphus Wabara.
I'm even talking about this administration.
Yeah, this administration.
What I'm trying to say is that there should be no Malami. Should not be bigger. We're not saying that he's guilty. I'm not saying master of party that he's guilty is, but. To fulfill investigation.
Yes.
Okay. All right. Let's take a call from Plateau, and I hear Elia is on the line. Good evening. Welcome.
Thank you very much.
Yeah.
You see, maybe those people that are discussing this thing, we from the Middle Belt, we know what is happening in the North. We know what is happening. They will play you hunky-panky, use you. After using you, they would like to dump you. You see, the truth is that Malini cannot stand and tell Nigerians that he do not know that person. And that man cannot just create that he is a consultant to him. So if Nigeria truly want to find out this issue, Malini should step out of the office just the way they did to Justice Onelge. You understand me? The truth in Nigeria is so difficult. We don't like saying the truth in Nigeria. We in the Middle Belt know what is happening in Nigeria. You people are the Far East. You will never understand it. But we understand what is happening.
I don't know about Ebeka and the poor. I'm not from the Far East. I'm from the Southeast.
Okay,
so because it's the inside.
What affects one affects all. We are journalists, yes. So
we are in the same boat, exactly. Leah. But thank you, we got you first time. But you know, there have been honorable men in Nigeria, and there still are honorable men in this country. They may be far and few, and you know, few and far between. Remember, late President Shagari's first IG was a gentleman called Adamu Suleiman. He resigned his office and told Mr. President, I don't feel do that dirty work. And he left before Mr. Sunday Adewusi stepped in.
You saw what Adewusi
did. The rest, they say, is history. So, AGF Malami, please, it is time for you to reinvent yourself, because you can. You can. You can. Yeah, so, all right, let's go on a break now. This is still Journalist Hangout. We bring facts and use these facts to mold opinion for you and expect you to do something with those facts. We'll be back shortly. All right, folks, let's go to our last story. You know, politics, according to the British publisher Ernest Benn, is the art of looking for trouble, finding it everywhere, diagnosing it incorrectly, and applying the wrong remedies. You know, the fourth citizen of this country, that's the Speaker of the House, Femi Badjabiamila, has justified his support for direct primaries in the Electoral Amendment Bill. According to him, public servants come on, will be more accountable to the people, and the youths will be more encouraged to take part in the process. Sports Minister, who is also the Youth Minister for Youth Affairs, Sunday Dare, had led a delegation of youths to the Speaker's office to say thank you. Well, Emeka, there's a difference between an opinion that sounds good and a good-sounding opinion.
Yeah, of course.
But in a democracy, there should be free choice. You should not, in trying to advance democracy, limit the choices of people. Yes, direct primaries, yes, of course. All the members of the political parties must be involved in choosing candidates. But the other question
this is where the direct primary comes
in. Yeah, the direct primary, then the indirect is about using delegates. Then you also have consensus. Now, when you foist direct primaries on the people through a bill, you know, through the amendment of a bill that's supposed to advance democracy, then, of course, it sounds more, you know, it sounds more like a thinking that sounds good. But the outcome is unrealistic. For instance, how do you expect INEC to monitor direct primaries in all the wards, you know, for all the parties? That's expensive. We are borrowing left and right. We say, I mean, the economy is weak. And then we are imposing additional bodies on the same economy. How many people are working at INEC that we expect that they can monitor all the direct primaries of political parties? Because the amended electoral Act says that INEC must monitor the primaries of political parties. So how is NN going to do it with the number of political parties we have in the country? And then, even if you say direct primaries, if the intent is to prevent certain people, in this case, governors, let's just say the way it is, governors from hijacking the process, then I just say that you are only postponing the evil day, because they will know, you know, Nigerian politicians, when they are so desperate about whatever advances their selfish interest, they will find a way around it. The members of the party,
the Rivers governor is known to have said, if the bill is passed to Mr. President, I will go to court.
Yes, of course. Of course, people should go to court to get that amendment, certain aspects of the amended act, you know, upturned. Because you cannot...
But let's even expand your logic. Yes. Direct primaries involves everybody.
Everybody, you know. Yes.
So what can be wrong with that?
Yes, there's nothing wrong with it. It is good. But at the same time, what is wrong with it is that in a democracy, you don't limit choice. That's why we've been kicking against a one-party state. That's why we've been saying, that's why there was a clamor for more political parties. Mm-hmm. So you don't have a one-party or two-party or three-party state.
Yeah.
So when you expand democracy and allow, you know, different interests to come to play, you don't then now turn it to a funnel, you know, with a big wide brim.
And that was the small counter logic is with the indirect primary, which allows the governor to
godfatherism and all of that. But the point is this: we should strive to build our democracy, to nurture our democracy to the point that people are very interested in participating. The question you have to ask is, who is actually funding the political parties? Are the people paying dues?
They are not.
Are the people interested in activities of political parties? Or do they engage political parties only on the day of election? That is why politicians will spend money trying to buy votes instead of using that money to advance the interests of their political parties.
I know that, Paul, you would have heard this, the story. It says, if votes actually determined outcome of elections, the politicians will outlaw it. No, you don't hear.
Well, that's Nigeria for you. I, for one, I support the
direct,
direct primary. Because what we have seen happen is indirect primary has allowed godfatherism to fester.
Yeah.
It has denied people. It has not allowed...
Because the governor determines which delegates go and don't who don't go.
Very powerful. The delegates they induce and, you know, to not necessarily to vote their conscience, but, you know, when money is talking. Direct primary is just a way of saying, let all the registered members of a party have a choice in determining who becomes their...
Free choice.
Exactly, exactly. Now, if we are saying, fine, that is going to be very laborious for INEC to supervise. I think where there is a will, there is a way. The truth of how does INEC supervise even general elections? You understand? How do they conduct general elections? You know, I think where there is a will, there is a way. You know, we have seen a situation in this country where people, a few persons come together and determine the choice of a party. And that's how you keep people having disgruntled people, they keep leaving the party. Because once they cannot, once they see that there's no fairness, it is not compulsory that you must achieve your dream. But the truth is that if you are going to lose,
fairness is relative.
If I'm going to lose, let it be that I lose in a fair context. You understand?
But by the way, don't let Emeka hear this. Have you heard that Andy Uba is set to go to court to challenge me out? Emeka, I hope you are not listening to us.
I heard that. For me, that seems very absurd, because the consensus about the Anambra election, apart from the itches, glitches, the consensus that it was a free and fair election, and it's even the book of that. Andy Uba came, what was his position in that?
Number three.
Number two is not complaining. And it came a distant third, you know.
Number two has congratulated.
Yeah. And all of
number
that.
Number four, number five, and all
that. But it's his choice. He has the right to go.
Aren't you folks surprised, or if not flabbergasted that Nigerian politicians are bad losers and also bad winners.
Yes, it's unfortunate. That's what I was talking about, building the system. Okay, we talk about fairness, but did you hear what the ADP candidate, the ADP member of the House of Representatives said on the floor of the House when he was defecting to APC? He said, I'm back home. The APC is my home. I only went to ADP when I couldn't get a ticket in APC. I went to ADP, got the ticket, won. I mean, can you imagine? That's an insult on the people, on the members of that party. So you just took them for a ride. You went, just picked ticket, you know, just walked into the party's office, picked the ticket. Come on. We must build confidence in our democracy. What is Godfatherism? Is it not the same set? Is it not Nigerians who impose Godfatherism? Even when you, okay.
In fact, they are behaving like substitutes for democracy.
Do you know what? Let's even do an audit of results of direct primaries across the country in the last few years. You will see such big figures, such large figures, that so and so hundreds of thousands voted for this candidate. But on election day, those party members suddenly disappear. You now record low voter turnout. So what happens? Is it that ghosts, you know, are inserted into the party list, into the membership list? Who are, where are those people, you know, those hundreds of thousands?
Tells me that you, said you don't, you know, believe in miracles.
Well, based, I believe in miracles, but you see, the type that Nigerian politicians try to sell to us.
Invent, yeah.
No. You, they are not, it's not, it's what the eyes can see. It's very clear. You claim that hundreds of thousands of people voted for a particular, in fact, in a particular state in the north, over 1 million, about, they said over 2 million registered. voted for the particular person candidate that became the governor.
Yeah.
At the primary election, only for, you know, during the election, what was recorded? Just a little over 1 million. So where did 1 million plus disappear to?
But so he's still battling with miracles and so on. In politics, anything is possible. You have heard that in politics, 2 times 2 is not 4, it is 22.
That's mathematics, not mathematics.
Okay, mathematics. I like.
So you have all sorts going on. Yes, I understand what he's saying. It's part of the problem we have with the politicians. It's a serious, serious problem. I hope we'll come to a point where people will just say, no.
Sorry, Paul, let me stop you. My brother Basi is reaching us from Abuja. Basi, good evening.
Yeah, good evening, sir.
Yeah, welcome.
Good evening.
Yeah. Hello, good evening.
Yeah, go on.
Okay, yeah. I want to just contribute on the direct primary, yeah?
Yeah.
When I hear the issue of an indirect primary, a direct primary more costly than the indirect primary, I don't think whether people understand what is an indirect primary. Because if you understand what is an indirect primary, you will know that you first need to do a direct primary and before you do an indirect primary. Because in an indirect primary, 2 sets of delegates are involved. First is statutory delegate, and the second is an elected delegate. So the elected delegate needs to face the members of the party to vote them first. It is after when elected delegates are in the image that you now put the 2 delegates together and then do the indirect primary. So when the issue of funding, you know, people keep talking about, you know, direct primary, you will spend more. I do not agree. I do not agree. In an indirect primary, that's where you even spend more, because you have 2 sets of election. A man that is contesting, you know, for the ticket of the party first need to mobilize his people to image and delegate as direct from the members. And then after that, you now subject him to another leg of election that is a combination of elected and a statutory delegate. So when it raised the issue of funding, that this, I don't think that is right. That's number one. Number two.
So for you, for Barsi, sorry, for you, it is the direct primary.
Yes, it is a direct primary. But okay. As I'm trying to, I don't want to remove the fact of funding. Funding is more in an indirect, except there's something that you are not telling us.
Yeah, okay. Well, Emeka is not a politician, but that's...
But I report politics.
Okay.
Yes.
Sorry.
You know,
when they want to do their magic,
I wonder if Nicola is talking about Nigeria.
no, but he is.
He's talking about two sets of elections. We are in Nigeria. When governors compile the list and just submit the list
in an indirect primary,
in a primary held on the table of the governor.
Okay,
it's on the table of the governor that the Nicola is talking about is held.
The man was talking about the ideal situation.
He was talking about what exists in the United States.
The thrust of his logic is that in the direct primary, you spend a lot less money than you would spend in an indirect one, where a lot of money is...
What about in the case of the APC primaries in Anambra that INEC didn't witness? INEC said his officials were there from morning till 5 p.m. You know, and even the Minister of Labor and Employment, Ngige, Dr. Chris Ngige, said he didn't even know where the direct primary held in his own hometown. I mean, somebody who was governor of the state, didn't even know. So, what are we talking about?
INEC should not be acting helpless. INEC is a regulator.
Yes.
If the law says that INEC must monitor an election, and INEC does not know what happened, INEC should not accept the candidate of that party. You are not there as figurehead. You are a regulator. For God's sake, it is independent national. Like independent,
but you know, in Nigeria, when there's an emphasis on that independent, you know, it could mean some other things.
All right, folks. I think this is where we want to apply the brakes, but we have made our points. These are based on facts available to us, so we have helped mold opinion. We talked about Niger State. Mentioned banditry and the wahala with banditry. Some people invaded the home of a Chief Justice of the Supreme Court, and now we are talking politics and so on. That's it. Our job is done. But let me drop this, Paul and Emeka. Mrs. Hussein was a year older yesterday.
Yeah, happy birthday. Okay,
happy birthday.
Yeah, yeah.
We felicitate with that.
Long life, prosperity.
At least I do this so that I spend a lot less.
Yes.
Madam, I greet you.
Yes.
11-11.
She's the one keeping the citizen
fresh.
Keeping him fresh, young, agile, and able to take care of the home.
You make me want to ask,
everywhere.
Has she a choice? All right, we have a choice now of going home, but not before thanking all of you folks for being part of it, from the studio to the director's office. From here, the backroom boys say thank you for watching another show, making it happen. And don't forget to team up with us at 1:30 on Sunday for a two-hour hangout show. We are on YouTube at youtube.com/TVC News Nigeria. Sorry we couldn't get Babajide Kolade Otitoju on Skype. Better luck next time. But I know Jide is doing fine. Okay, I'm Citizen Jones. Bye-bye now. Take care.